Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and this is the 2020 MacBook Pro 13-inch with the all-new M1 Apple Silicon in it. And this starts at $1,299 and goes up to $2,299 in the United States. It comes with 8 or 16 gigabytes of RAM, and you can configure it from 512 gigabytes to 2 terabytes. This is the top-of-the-line model with 16 gigs of RAM and 2 terabytes of storage. It also has the Apple M1 chip in it, which is an 8-core CPU, 8-core GPU, and 16-core neural engine. It comes in silver or space gray. Let's go ahead and open it up. So we'll take the package cover off here. And I haven't seen one of these in person, but the frame of this hasn't really changed. Let's take the top of the box off. And we'll do a comparison with the new MacBook Air a little bit as well. So we'll set the top of the box aside. Here's the MacBook Pro, and it's in space gray. I know some people really like the silver. I prefer space gray with that. And then here is a USB-C adapter that comes in the box. And then we've got some paperwork. And we have a MacBook Pro starter guide, a little warranty card, along with two space gray Apple stickers. Now also, we have a different adapter than what we get with the MacBook Air. So this should be the 60 watt adapter, I believe. Let's see if I can pull this out of here. And as you can see here, it's 61 watts. So it's a USB-C adapter to help charge it because this has a larger battery and may have a more demanding workflow. So let's go ahead and set the box aside. And here is the new MacBook Pro. Let's go ahead and open it up. And let's look around the outside and then we'll turn it on. I'll get it set up and we'll check a few other things out. Now, this is the same as the previous MacBook Pro 13-inch, although it has two less ports. So on the right-hand side, we just have a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. On the back, nothing here, just the aluminum frame. On the left-hand side, we have Thunderbolt 3 / USB 4 ports, two of them. And then on the front, it looks the same. You have the normal feet on the bottom with the different screws around it. Let me go ahead and set this down. And we'll open it up here. And it should turn on by itself. And we'll wait for it to boot up. It usually doesn't take too long. And there's a couple nice things that we have in here. Of course, we have Touch ID, just like we've had for a while now. We have the touch bar, and they kept the escape key, which is great if you're a programmer or you just want a physical escape key. And you'll see the keyboard layout is pretty much everything we expect, and it's backlit as well. So if I turn the lights off, you'll see that it's backlit. It will light up a little bit, and let's turn the keyboard up. You can turn it up or down, and you get the idea. So the MacBook Air is wedge-shaped. The MacBook Pro is not. So let me bring these together here. You'll see the MacBook Pro is not wedge-shaped, so it's a little bit different there. And the MacBook Pro is a little bit heavier at 3 pounds or 1.4 kilograms. The Air is 2.8 pounds or 1.29 kilograms. So there's a slight weight difference, but you get a much bigger battery in the MacBook Pro. Now let me go ahead and set this up. I'll compare a few things, and we'll see what it's like to use for a little bit with some intense tasks. Now, one thing I wanted to point out I showed in my MacBook Air unboxing is when you first set up your new MacBook, you have an accessibility option for vision, motor, hearing, or cognitive help. So if you need a little extra help, it's right at the beginning. I love that they put this here, and I just wanted to point that out. So I'll go into the Apple here, go to About This Mac, and you can see it's the 16 gigabyte variant. So this is 16 gigs of RAM. The MacBook Air has 8 gigs of RAM. Let's go ahead and close this. And this has 2 terabytes of storage. The MacBook Air has 512. We'll go into Geekbench 5. And in Geekbench 5, you can see it's clocked at 3.2 gigahertz, has 16 gigabytes of RAM, where the MacBook Air has the same clock speed, 3.2 gigahertz, and has 8 gigs of RAM. If we run the CPU benchmark, I would expect them to be the same, but let's go ahead and run that and see what we've got. Now the Geekbench score is completed and you can see that the MacBook Pro was slightly slower. Now I would think this is because there's a lot going on in the background. It's completing a lot of tasks. As you can see here with iStat menu, the CPU is in use and it got this score. So the CPU is doing some work in the background. If we go to Activity Monitor and open it up, we can see what's using the CPU and the process named Bird is using the most. So that's utilizing 88% of the CPU right now, doing some tasks in the background, completing setup. So for it to actually get those scores while doing work in the background is fairly impressive, but they're the same CPU. So I would think they're the same. And also this is running macOS 11.0. It will need to be updated. Let me go ahead and go to the, we'll close this and then we'll go to the compute score. And we have OpenCL, of course. Let's just run it and see what we get. We'll go ahead and run the compute score. And there we go. This time, the compute score was actually higher on the MacBook Pro at 19,049 versus 18,724. And so there's a little bit of a difference there. Now let's go ahead and close that. And let's see if we see any difference with another application, and maybe I can really push this and see if we can get it a little bit warm. Normally these don't hardly get hot at all, and since the MacBook Air doesn't have a fan in it and the Pro does, let's see what we can do. I'll open Cinebench and sort of push this machine as much as I can here. So we've got Cinebench R23. We'll go ahead and wait for it to load on both. Let me close out Geekbench and Activity Monitor. Do the same here. And let's go ahead and do a CPU multi-core test and see what happens here. So you'll see there's still processes going on in the background on the MacBook Pro, but let's see what we can do and push it and see what kind of scores we get. So we'll go ahead and hit start and let's see what happens here. So it's performing a render test. Now, a couple things to note on the MacBook Pro, you can see here's the different load averages, and the MacBook Pro just started to spin up its fan. I can barely hear it. It's super quiet, but it is there. So the fan is spinning. Let me move my microphone and see if you can actually hear it as well. Now, another thing to note is the temperature of these is fairly cool. The temperature sensor on this wasn't working, so I don't know if Apple doesn't allow that here, but the MacBook Air feels a little bit warm right here. On a previous generation MacBook Air, this would be hot. Right now, it's just a little bit warm. On the MacBook Pro, I can feel a little bit of heat here as well. But one thing to note is that the CPUs are maxed out and not throttling. So we'll see what happens, but it's at 99% utilization on both of them, which is really impressive. You can see that it's spiking the CPU and it's just staying there as it completes this task. So it's really impressive. Now you'll see that Cinebench is completed on the MacBook Pro. It's still going on the MacBook Air, and now it just completed. So on the MacBook Air, it scored 7,214. On the MacBook Pro, it scored 7,713 because it was able to keep the processor cool enough to keep pushing at full speed. So let's go ahead and try a single core. We'll push it again and see what it's doing. Now keep in mind, the battery's at 12% on the MacBook Air. So I've never charged the MacBook Air other than the transfer that I showed you earlier with the Thunderbolt cable. So let's go ahead and see what this does with single core and see how it sustains the load. The peak load on the MacBook Pro was 29, where the MacBook Air is 11. So it's pretty interesting. We'll give it a little bit. Now Cinebench is completed for single core, and the MacBook Pro was 1 point better at 1,493 versus 1,492. The multi-core is where there was the biggest difference because you could sustain the loads with the Pro a little bit longer. So you had a higher score. So sustained workloads with doing multi-core intensive tasks will work better on the Pro, obviously. Let's go ahead and close out Cinebench. And let's go ahead and close that out. And let's take a look at and see if there's any difference exporting video. And then I'll try a couple apps that people were asking about. Now, I did have to plug in the MacBook Air because the battery got really low. It's the first time I've plugged it in, and the test only used about 6%. But still, let's go ahead and see what we can do. So I'll delete the generated media files. This is the exact same video I imported into Final Cut Pro. It's actually my iOS 14.3 beta 1 video. We'll go to File, Share, and we'll go to Master File. And we'll go to Settings. We'll make sure they're the same. We'll go to Video and Audio, H.264. And so this is actually H.265 footage. It will be 8 gigabytes when it's completely compressed and rendered. We'll hit next. I'm just going to select the same place. We'll hit save, hit start on the stopwatch, see how long it takes, and let's open it up. Now I disconnected the MacBook Air from power. We're at 30% battery. And let me show you the CPU here as well. You can just kind of get an idea how it's spiking, and we'll see how fast it exports. So the MacBook Pro was able to complete this task in about 12 minutes and 10 seconds, where it took about 43 to 44 more seconds for the MacBook Air to complete the same thing. Now, one thing I didn't mention at the beginning of the video is it took 12 minutes, but this is an 8-minute video. Now, normally it would be faster. It just depends on how you encode this, but that's pretty impressive either way, depending on how many titles you have and everything else. So let's go ahead and close that. Move this out of the way. Let's take a look and see if disk speed test is any different. Now I've got disk speed test open on both, and we've got it set to 1 gigabyte on both. So I'll go ahead and hit start and let's see. They should be about the same, although because the MacBook Pro has a bigger drive, it's possible it'll be faster. But right now they're both getting about 3,600 megabytes per second write and 2,800 read on the MacBook Air. Now, this is actually a Rosetta app. It's running an application through Apple's software that allows it to run virtually through here. Since this is an M1 Mac, this app is not optimized for it. So you'll see it's actually a little bit slower read speed on the MacBook Pro at 2,400 megabytes per second versus 2,800, which is kind of interesting, but either way, it's very fast on both. Now, along with what I've already shown, this will run Microsoft Office apps, no problem running them from the App Store. I showed that on a different video, but also this will run Adobe's products, but those are not native apps. So they will install and work, but they're not native. You also have the option for iPad and iOS apps. So if you want to watch or want to try anything from the optimized Mac apps to, say, we'll say Pixelmator, for photos, that's what I use. And up at the top, you have iPhone and iPad apps. So you can switch between iPhone and iPad apps, but not everything is supported. Now, one major difference between them is their battery. The MacBook Pro has a larger battery of 58.2 watt hours versus 49.9 watt hours. So you get a couple more hours of use out of the MacBook Pro, 17 hours of wireless web versus 15, and 18 hours of Apple TV versus 20. And both of them only support one external monitor up to 6K, a Pro Display XDR or anything else, but just one. It will use the monitor on the display here and the other monitor, or you can close it in closed clamshell mode. Now, one area where the MacBook Pro is a lot better is in its speakers and also its microphone. So let me move the MacBook Air over and let's go to QuickTime and go to File, New Movie Recording. And let's record from the MacBook itself. So now I'm recording from the MacBook Pro with its studio microphones. It has the same sort of studio microphones as you get with the 16-inch MacBook Pro, for example. But we still have a 720p webcam. So they haven't improved that at all, but it should be better due to the neural engine. It should respond better, have better lighting. I'm not sure that it's great, but it's fine for web calls and things like that, but not for video recording. So just keep that in mind. So go ahead and hit stop there. And then we'll go ahead and export as a 720p video. That's as high as you can go. And MacBook Pro webcam. We'll see how fast it is to save. And we're done. We'll delete it. And now I have it saved. So it's pretty good that way. Let's take a listen to the speakers. So let me open YouTube here. I'll maximize this. And we have 4K resolution. Let me move the microphone so you can hear it. Was with notifications, and that's it. So that's pretty simple. There's also some additional updates to music as well in the control center. So whatever you were last playing will show up, of course. So the speakers do sound pretty good. They've got a nice wide stereo sound, and the display also goes 100 nits brighter on the Pro as compared to the Air. So it is a little bit brighter here. So let's go ahead and see if we can turn it all the way up. We'll turn this all the way up. It'll be too blown out for the camera, but you'll get the idea. We'll turn it back down. And one thing you do get on the MacBook Pro, because you have the touch bars, you can adjust the keyboard brightness right here, although it's disabled for some reason. So we can adjust it, but not right now. So it's disabled. Maybe it needs to sense that there's no light. Now I can adjust it. So it sensed that there was no light. I can adjust it from the touch bar here, which I can't do on the MacBook Air. So that's pretty nice that we have that option. And once it senses light, it doesn't allow you to adjust the keyboard brightness, probably to save battery life. Now both have Wi-Fi 6 and Bluetooth 5.0. They support all of the previous versions of Wi-Fi 802.11 A, B, G, N, A, C, and now AX with Wi-Fi 6. And they've got basically the same thing, although the MacBook Pro has a larger battery. So honestly, I would go for the MacBook Pro if you're going to upgrade the MacBook Air at all. If you need more storage, maybe I'd just jump to the Pro because it has that extra fan so it can process things a little bit more long term, or if you want to edit video or photos, and then also you get that longer battery life. And if you like the touch bar, if you really don't, of course, you can get the physical keys as well. Now I'll close the MacBook Air, and I know a couple people want to see this even though I said it. So again, you can run Microsoft Word, for example. You'll see how fast this is just kind of zipping through this. We'll download it and install it. It'll take just a moment. So Microsoft Word is downloaded. So let's go ahead and open it up for the first time. We'll wait for it here. The first time will always take the longest. I'll just skip to read-only mode. We'll just zip through it. And now we're in. So go to whatever document I'd like, and now we can just use the document. So it works just like you'd expect. It's Word, and if you have an account with Office 365 or any of those, you can use it. And then again, I've shown this works with Excel and all of those things as well. So I wouldn't necessarily run out and get one of these if you use Photoshop or Premiere yet until they have more native support, but it runs those okay. Everything I've used so far has actually been really fast. So I use Final Cut Pro and Pixelmator Pro. Everything's incredibly fast. In fact, it's as fast as my Mac Pro in my test. So that's the part that's really impressive and surprising to me in regular use. So I can edit H.265 video no problem. And I think for most people, the Pro is probably the correct one to get, depending on what you want. So it's great. It's light enough. It's close enough to the MacBook Air. But let me know if there's anything else specifically you want to know about it. Hopefully Adobe will get their apps ready for this faster if you want to use their apps. But since they charge monthly, I tend to use the Apple apps or Final Cut and the other things that are alternate to that. I also find they run better as well. Let me know if you have any additional questions in the comments below, and I'll link these wallpapers from all of the Big Sur wallpapers in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe, and if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.